Francisco, on the other hand, locks up a quarterback in the future. It now has a building block on a team that has gotten battered with injuries this season, particularly this week in Philadelphia, where they barely had enough players to finish the game. They made the decision tonight they're going to be releasing Brian Hoyer.
Yes, yes, yes. This is The Butcher Shop. I am the butcher boy, Joe Shasky. If you like what you see, hit the subscribe button. Leave your comments and suggestions below. Thank you for joining me. Fired up! The 49ers make a huge, shocking move today. The San Francisco 49ers trade their second-round pick in the 2018 draft for quarterback Jimmy Garoppolo from the New England Patriots, the backup to the GOAT, Tom Brady. And there's so many angles that we can take on this. So many people are ready to rush to conclusions, jump to their judgments. I didn't even know what to make of it at first. I was in shock and awe, absolute shock and awe. I was blown away that the front office was ballsy enough to actually do this. And there's so many things to like, and there's so many things to be skeptical of. So anybody who's making a hard line, I would say, let's look at the data. Let's take a step back. Let's take a step back and let's really look at the data and let's break it down from every single angle. What did the Niners give up? What are they really going to be getting in Jimmy Garoppolo? What does this mean for the future? Okay? And why would Belichick get rid of this guy? All right? So let's get right into it. I mean, what did the 49ers actually give up to get this quarterback who we've only seen play in a couple of games, okay, for the New England Patriots? Well, the 49ers acquired a 25-year-old turning 26 this week young quarterback who was an absolute stud in college at Eastern Illinois, the same school that Tony Romo went to, who has been sitting in the wings, waiting in the shadow of Tom Brady. And if you talk to any Patriot fan, all you've heard is Jimmy G is the future. And we were all under the assumption that either Belichick could have traded him for multiple first-round picks, refused to trade him to Cleveland. Maybe he was going to re-sign him this offseason. Maybe he was going to franchise tag them. So much money being tied up to the New England quarterback position. What was New England going to do? So the 49ers gave up what would be their second round pick. And right now, as of today, they're 0-8. It's looking like that pick would have ended up being the 33rd, 34th, maybe the 35th pick, meaning we would have had a top three pick in the first round. And in the second round, it's basically a first round pick. So how did we get this extra second round pick I'm hearing about from the Saints? Well, remember, we traded back last year with the Bears so they could move up to get Trubisky. So we had two second round picks, and we only gave up supposedly our top end 33rd, 34th, or 35th projected pick as of right now. So, you know, a lot to dissect amongst that alone. You know, many people are saying that's just way too much to give up for a guy we don't really know much about. That's, why would you give up a second rounder? That's essentially a third rounder. Well, let's just look back at some of the players that the 49ers have taken with their second round picks. Because when you look at this list, you look at who they've taken in the second round, it is not an all-world, all-pro, Hall of Fame bunch. In fact, there's a lot of head scratchers. So in 2017, they don't take anyone. 2016, they don't take anyone. Because in both years, they traded back into the first round to get a second player later on in the first round pick. 2015, Jaquaski Tart. He's an okay player. 2014, Carlos Hyde. Carlos Hyde's nice, gonna be a free agent soon. Are they gonna re-sign him? We don't know. You know, the guy's been so hit and miss. Can he stay healthy? 2013, Tank Carradine. Still waiting to see anything from Tank Carradine. He's been a complete bust. 2012, LaMichael James. Complete bust. Waste. The guy fumbled in the Super Bowl. That's about the only thing I can remember from LaMichael James. And again, I like that pick on draft day because he was a stud and we needed a dynamic playmaker. But he did nothing for us. 2011, I would say, is probably the best of all the second round picks if we're going back 15 years for the 49ers, and that's Colin Kaepernick. Great pick in the second round. He gave us 3-4 great seasons. We got to inches, one fade pass away from a Super Bowl. Colin Kaepernick would be the best one. But 6 years later, he's not even in the NFL, and there's many reasons why. But let's continue to go down the list. In 2010, Taylor Mays, huge bust, couldn't even play the position, looked like Adonis, played like Jane. We all love Taylor Mays coming out of USC, but let's be honest, he was terrible, absolutely terrible. 2009, we didn't have a second round pick. 2008, we took the Matador, you know who I'm talking about, Chilo Rashal. Yeah, he stunk, absolutely stunk. Let's keep going, because we didn't have second round picks in 2007 and 2006. But in 2005, a similar year to this year, we ended up with the number one overall pick and took Alex Smith. Well, we have the 33rd overall pick in the second round. And who did Mike Nolan take? Mike Nolan took Michigan center guard David Boss. And David had better years for the New York Giants than he ever did for us. He was a bust for us. There's no way around it. 2004, let's look at Justin Smiley, a guard. Yeah, Smiley had some decent years, but let's be honest, we're not blowing anyone away with any of these picks. And then in 2003, Anthony Adams, who ended up playing for the Bears, playing pretty well for the Niners. But again, of all those second round picks, have the Niners been hitting home runs? Have they been developing any of these players? No, no, they haven't. This is a great opportunity to get great value, absolutely great value with this second round pick. And historically, the 49ers have proven that they can't really parlay that second round pick, even if it's a high second round pick, into a development player, a star player, a blue chip player, a cornerstone player. All of these guys that I named, Jaquaski Tartt's the only guy on the roster who's got a contract for next season. Even Carlos Hyde is up in the air, and I like Carlos. So it's not like the 49ers over the years have absolutely crushed it with their second round picks. And if you look at league-wide, okay, if we were to look league-wide, who are the rest of the league taking? What quarterbacks have been selected in the second round? Well, if you look at the Hall of Fame, just the Hall of Fame alone, in the second round, it's Kenny Stabler for the Raiders, the lucky lefty out of Alabama in 1968, and it's Brett Favre, who, ironically, had to be traded from the Atlanta Falcons for a draft pick to go to Green Bay in a more perfect situation under a quarterback guru in Mike Holmgren, who has ties to the San Francisco 49er franchise, just like Mike Shanahan does, just like his son Kyle Shanahan does. So there's a lot of similarities there. And if you look in the league right now, currently, all the different second round picks, there's only a couple that really stick out. Second round quarterback selections. And that's Derek Carr, who was taken at that 34, 35, 36 range where we would have been picking. And Carr's been a stud, there's no doubt. He's taken some regression this year, but any 49er fan would love to have Derek Carr on their team right now. You look at Andy Dalton. Yeah, they gave him a little too much money, but Andy's been a very serviceable starter over the last 6 years. Colin Kaepernick, we all know that he's had some extreme highs and some extreme lows. Drew Brees is probably the best of this bunch, and that's just the last 20 years, second round picks, what we're looking at, and Drew Brees had to bounce around for 7, 8, 9 years, from San Diego to New Orleans to find the right situation, being paired up again with an offensive coordinator at just the right time to find his Hall of Fame platform and success. The list of second round quarterbacks around the league, okay? DeShone Kizer, Geno Smith, weak. Drew Stanton, career backup. Pat White, I mean, did he even start at quarterback for the Miami Dolphins? I think they moved him to wide receiver. John Beck, garbage. Kevin Cobb, we'll get to him later, garbage. Jimmy Garoppolo, okay? He was drafted in the second round just a few years ago. Brock Osweiler, he stinks. Chad Henne, he's terrible. Kellen Clemens, Jimmy Clausen, Quincy Carter, garbage, garbage, garbage. Marquise Tuiasosopo, who I like. I like Marquise Tuiasosopo, but let's be real, backup at best. And then the last guy on the list is Brian Brohm. That's not a good, sexy list in the second round. So even if the 49ers were to keep the second round pick, the 33rd, 34th, 35th overall pick, what are the chances that they were actually going to find an impact player at any position? Look at their draft history. And especially at the quarterback position. So now you're getting a face of the franchise at value. He was drafted in the second round. 3 years later, he develops on someone else's dime under Hall of Fame tutelage, both by Belichick and Tom Brady, seeing it firsthand. He's a great teammate by all accounts. Never said boo-hoo the entire time about playing time. And how could you? You're behind the GOAT. But you get this guy for a second round pick, all right? On top of that, let's look at the free agency moving into this year. Were we really going to want to pay and allocate in a salary cap league $31, $32, $33 million for an older 30 years old Kirk Cousins? Jimmy Garoppolo right now today is 25, turning 26 this week. You're going to get him signed and under the cap for at least two-thirds, maybe $20 million, who knows, somewhere in that ballpark, but much, much cheaper than a Kirk Cousins, which allows this team that has no other pieces across the board to make some splashes in free agency and bring in top flight receivers, whether that's an Allen Robinson, a Keenan Allen who might be available. Maybe that's an Adamakong Su on defense or a Jadeveon Clowney. Who knows? Offensive line? Maybe we could throw some money at the offensive line so that this young quarterback that you just acquired stays upright? My point being, there's a lot of value here. Financial value, draft value, franchise value. And I think the 49ers hit pay dirt here. I like what I see just looking at the metrics, the data from who they've selected in the last 15 years in the second round, who's been available in the second round in the quarterback market, and who's going to be available next year. This speaks to me that Kyle was not infatuated at all with any of the quarterbacks coming out. And one of the main reasons why I really like this, I really, 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 really like this draft select, this trade, is because the 49ers desperately need an adult. They need a mature quarterback. They need a mature leader. It's one of the things that I'm watching Deshaun Watson, and this is a man who is wise upon his years. He's very mature, and he provides a level of stability and confidence and that calm that you need at the quarterback position. For too long, the 49ers have lacked that leader. They truly have. Even when Colin was ripping up the NFL, he wasn't the leader on the team. He shouldn't have been. He was a young player, and they were all pro blue chip superstars across the roster. There's no way Colin could have stepped in and been that leader. This gives Jimmy a chance to establish himself on a team desperately needing character, desperately needing an identity, desperately needing a mature leader. They're finally getting a mature leader. Now, can this bust? Can this not work? Can this be a Kevin Cobb situation where Kevin Cobb looked great as a backup for Andy Reid, Arizona pulls the trigger, and they end up getting themselves a lemon? Of course. Of course there's a bustability factor to this, but there's also a bustability factor for Kirk Cousins in free agency and for any second round pick that you were gonna keep, all right? So if you look at the history of the 49er draft picks, they've had a lack of identifying the right player and then a lack of developing that player. At the very least, Kyle has identified who he wants. This guy's already got some development in an elite first-class offense with a first-class head coach. He's proven that when given the opportunity with other good players around him, he can execute the game plan. And that's another thing. Let's talk about what we're actually getting in Jimmy Garoppolo. Who is Jimmy Garoppolo? What's this player like? Well, I looked at his first two games, and yes, I just looked at the highlights, and everyone's highlights are going to look great. But here's the comp that I see. I see a guy, and they're going to make the comparison a lot this week because they went to the same school, Eastern Illinois. But you're going to see a guy who's got a little playmaking ability and a little mobility and escapability of a Tony Romo. But man, I like the way he slings it. Slings it like a Mark Bulger. For anyone who's a fan of the old NFC West, do not sleep on how well Mark Bulger could sling the rock for the greatest show on turf when Kurt Warner got bounced, okay? Mark Bulger used to hit his wide receivers in stride, throw them open, hit them in a spot where they could turn and go upfield. We've all watched C.J. Beathard this year. He struggles with accuracy. He struggles with hitting those quick little out passes so that the receiver can catch it and turn upfield, not have to turn around and get racked by a DB. Looking at the tape from his first two starts, again, two starts, but it was against Arizona defense that was considered elite at the time, and then he went up against Miami, a divisional opponent. He looked like he had poise, command. I saw great footwork. I saw a guy who could sling it accurately. I saw a guy who, when the play breaks down, had just enough escape ability with his eyes downfield to make great throws. I saw a lot of touch on a lot of his passes. I don't know if he's got a superstar arm, but there's a reason Bill Belichick was trying to re-sign him. If he could throw in that weather, Okay, that cold in New England with the wind, he could throw out here in Santa Clara where the conditions are going to be damn near perfect, or in LA, or in Arizona where the conditions are going to be damn near perfect on a week-to-week basis. The only place that you'd have to worry about weather pretty much would be November and late, and December late at home and up in Seattle all year with the rain. But this guy had enough arm strength and enough pop on his ball to make things happen. This looks like a really good trade on the surface, and I understand why you would be pessimistic. The 49ers, the ownership, John Lynch, you know, there's a lot of reasons to be pessimistic. I understand it. The Niners should have had Deshaun Watson. They could have had Leonard Fournette. They could have had Christian McCaffrey, Jamal Adams. Instead, they take Solomon Thomas. Well, you know what? Trading back has given them a war chest to where they can move a second round pick for an established quarterback who at least has proven he's an NFL player. Okay, and we're not just swinging and missing like the Browns did with Deshaun Kizer this year, where they don't even know what they have, and they're going to have to go right back in to the quarterback draft again this year. There is a lot to like, and again, when we go back to a salary cap league, it's all about value, and there's tons of value. There's value in the draft pick that you gave away. There's value in the quarterback you're bringing in, and here's the last caveat. Now there is value for your draft pick, that first pick, next year. And here's why. Because you've already taken your quarterback and you're assuming that we're going to have some sort of an extension, we're going to transition tag him, franchise him, something. He's going to be on the roster, okay? If that is a known entity and we're not taking a quarterback with that first overall pick, we are in a very valuable position. Now you've got the New York Giants and you've got the Cleveland Browns who are looking for quarterbacks. But now you're not. Okay, so any of the other teams that are out there, Arizona, or maybe it is the New York Giants who want to move up a spot, just like you did to Chicago this year, the value of the pick you have currently goes up, all right? Is it going to be multiple first rounders? Who knows? But you can at least squeeze that lemon, move down a spot or two or three, and still get a superstar impact player. Whether that's Saquon Barkley, whether that's one of the tackles from Notre Dame, because you desperately need to fix this O-line. This move gives you current flexibility with the quarterback situation. It gets you your franchise player. It allows you to really target free agency this year with a clear definition of what needs to be done. Add weapons, add offensive line. That's the same tactics that I'm looking for in the draft, okay? And now the value of that first pick has skyrocketed, and you can leverage that in any trade proposal moving forward. Now, does this preclude the 49ers from looking at other quarterbacks in the draft next year after the first round pick? Be it the second rounder, the third, fourth, whatever. You know what? You can still take a Baker Mayfield. Maybe another player, like the kid up in Washington State, Luke Falk, who's clearly not ready, you can take later in the draft, stash and develop, and do exactly what New England did this year, which was move an entity that you really weren't going to cash in on for some more equity, which you can use to acquire a player or trade off to get another piece to help you now. I'm telling you, this is a great short-term move. This is a good moving forward move. And this is a clear, definitive sense of urgency that the fan base needs. I am excited. It could go wrong. It could be horrible. There's no question. I'm not saying that this is bulletproof or that this is bust-proof. It is by far, a huge gamble. This is a huge roll of the dice. It's ballsy, it's gutsy, but I love it. I absolutely love it because it tells me that Kyle and John know that they need a quarterback and they need to get someone who's mature and ready to go. And in this division, when you look around, the Rams are having a great year, but they're on cap hell. They've got a lot of uncertainty moving forward. Sammy Watkins could be a free agent. Aaron Donald situation. Are they going to extend Todd Gurley? Lots of cap flux there, and they're right up against the salary cap. Arizona looks terrible. You're now ahead of Arizona in the arms race because you have a quarterback of the future that you can hang your hat on. And then Seattle will be Seattle for as long as Pete and Russ are there. But at least I know I've got one piece moving forward, which is the quarterback position. And again, It could flop. A year from now, we could be in the same situation we are now, where we needed a quarterback and we desperately reached for something. But you know what? You gotta swing and miss. And you gotta swing and miss big. This year, everyone was banking on maybe CJ Beathard being that guy in the third round. Well, I took a player with a second round pick, just 25, 35 picks ahead of you, who is ready to play right now, who has the maturity, the arm strength, and the grooming of elite coaching. This so reminds me of one of my favorite players of all time. And I'm not saying that this is who he is. I'm just saying the circumstances. In 1987, Bill Walsh traded for a young 26-year-old Steve Young, who needed to be taught the game, who needed a place to grow and sit back and go. And unlike Jimmy Garoppolo, who had to sit behind Tom Brady, okay, Steve Young was getting his head pounded in. And that's what would have happened to any quarterback we took, whether it was Deshaun Watson this year, Rosen, Darnold, whomever next year, okay? It is an overwhelming process to be 21 years old and go out with that shitty offensive line and no playmakers and go up against grown freaking men when you have no idea if this kid can even play and even handle it emotionally. We know Garoppolo can handle it emotionally. That is a known entity. Can he play? The jury's out. We will see. But from the video I saw someone who had great mobility, great pocket awareness, just enough escapability with his eyes downfield, and he threw a good, accurate ball. That is the most important. I saw a guy who got the ball out quick, decisive, and had phenomenal touch on the over the linebacker underneath the safety ball. And that is where you really move the chains, because that's that 12 to 18 yard range where you get past the corner or that second level of the linebackers, and now you're trying to attack that secondary. And that's where it separates the men from the boys in the NFL. Can you throw past the 10, 12, 14 yard mark? And it looks like Jimmy Garoppolo can. I'm very interested to see what the development of this wide receiver core does under a legitimate quarterback who's ready to get the ball out quick. Couple quick tidbits. Before they play this man, he needs to sit. We need to get Joe Staley back in the lineup. We need to see Trent Brown back in the lineup. At some point this year, I wanna see Trent Brown moved over to the left side. Let's just see it. I just wanna see it. Going into this draft, being where we are with that top three pick, having a Saquon Barkley staring at you in the face, this Notre Dame tackle who's apparently a superstar stud, I need to know what I need. I need to clearly know what I need. I don't necessarily see a top corner or a wide receiver that really sticks out to me at three. And that's why I think trading down now is gonna be good. We need multiple players. Don't kid yourself. We're still years away, okay? But this is a huge first step, and I'm excited. And I think you should be too, 49er fans. Why not? We've had nothing but misery over the last 4 years. Let's be optimistic. Let's rally around this guy. Let's support him. Jimmy G, baby! Welcome to the Niners. Welcome, baby. Let's see it. Look at his college numbers. Look at his highlights, all right? And let's listen to him talk. Remember, you guys all loved Kyle Shanahan when we signed him. Let's trust his football brain. We have to. We are in no other position but to trust his judgment. This is who he wants. I'm excited. I'm cautiously pessimistic on certain things, but I'm excited and I'm optimistic, and I truly hope that this is the guy we can hang our hat on for the next 5 to 10 years. I want that to happen. And again, this doesn't mean he's gotta be Joe Montana. Just be serviceable. Just provide us back into being competitive. We can win the division in a couple years if we stack the team. But this is a great first step. It's a huge swing and a miss. It's ballsy, but you gotta love it. You gotta freaking love it. I appreciate it, you guys. If you like what you see, hit the subscribe button. Leave your comments, suggestions below. I'm out, Niner fans. Woo! I gotta have faith.